Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Practice Parlour. I am here today with my friend Jenna Pastuszek, who is an incredible music theater performer and also a voice teacher. She is co-founder of Innovative Voice Studio. She has advanced degrees in vocal performance and vocal pedagogy from NYU. And she is a voiceover artist, and she is passionate about destigmatizing vocal injury. So that is what we're here to talk with you today about, all about vocal health, Jenna's experience with vocal injury, and her road to recovery. So hi, Jenna, and thank you so much for being here.
Hi, Gina, and thank you all for tuning in. I am so excited about this, and you know, the minute that you sent me my Facebook group invitation for the Self-Care for Singers group a few months ago, I was like, yes, join. I'm obsessed with this idea. So I'm super thrilled to be here and support all of the awesome work that you're doing.
Thank you. We're excited to have you. So before I forget, if anybody has any questions, please feel free to pop them in the chat and we will get to them during our discussion. So Jenna, if you could just start off by telling us a little bit about yourself and your journey just into being a singer and being a voice teacher.
Sure. So I'm originally from Swarthmore, Pennsylvania, which is a small town outside of Philadelphia. And I grew up around music. Neither one of my parents were musicians professionally, but you know, my family just had a love of music. Both of my grandmothers sung in their church choirs, and so the arts were very much a part of my life from an early age. So much so, in fact, that once, maybe when I was 7 or 8, my next door neighbors came over and they were talking to my mom, and they were like, you know, your daughter, have you considered putting her into therapy? And my mom was like, no, why? And they were like, well, it should either be therapy or musical theater school because she is singing to the trees in your backyard. And my mom was like, oh. And so they were like, how about musical theater class first? And so, you know, I started at this incredible organization called the Young People's Theater Workshop. When I was, I think, 9 or 10, and my first show ever was Annie, and no, I was not Annie. I was like Hoovervillian number 17, and I loved it. And from there, the woman who runs the program, Claudia Carlson, took me under her wing, and she connected me with a voice teacher in the Swarthmore area named Lelia Calder. And Lelia was an Alexander teacher and a classical teacher, and also was Estel trained. And so I started studying voice lessons, or started studying voice when I was 11. And when I was 12, she was like, you know what? I think you need to take a year off and study piano. And also, I had been sent to Lelia originally because the woman who ran the theater program was concerned about the way that I was belting. She was like, you're shouting and I think you're gonna hurt yourself. And I was like, okay, great. So I come from a classical, you know, training background, and I'm so grateful for that time in my life and the, you know, just focusing on the importance of classical head dominant singing as well as cultivating a belt. But that was what's really interesting, and the reason why I bring it up is because from a young age, I already had that light bulb of like, oh, you can hurt yourself. You can hurt yourself by singing and or speaking incorrectly. So this is something that I'm going to need to flag and like think about for the rest of my life. So I studied with Lelia till I was, you know, till I graduated from high school. And when I was going to college, I remember that one of my friends from home, Molly, her mom was like, oh, you're going to go to musical theater school. And I was like, no, I'm a person who does theater, not a theater person. So I'm going to go to like regular college. I want to go to football games. I want to be in a sorority. Like, I want to do this whole thing that, like, you know, the media has displayed as the college experience. And I think that was also me hiding, because I'd never been rejected. I didn't really know what it felt like to not get the thing that I was after. So I was too afraid to apply to undergraduate conservatory program. So I ended up at the University of Virginia, and I studied history, French, and elementary education. And I also sung in an a cappella group, all female a cappella group. And actually, that was where I got a lot of my pop rock training. So it's really come full circle, and I've used all of the things that I've studied. I just feel like I've gotten to my career with this like very roundabout way. And so when I was finishing up, I was student teaching fourth grade, and I was, you know, 20, 21, and I had this like quarter life crisis. It was the first time where I wasn't studying voice. I wasn't performing with the a cappella group anymore. And I was like, oh my God, something is not right in my life. I'm not singing. Singing is way more important to me than I've ever like let myself think about it before. Like, I have to pivot. I have to do everything else. I'm going to apply to grad school. And so I applied to NYU and Boston Conservatory, and I was very adamant that I wanted to do a master's of music in vocal performance for musical theater because I wanted to focus on my singing training. And so I applied to both of those programs in January. By April 1st, I still hadn't heard from NYU. And so I had accepted a teaching position, teaching elementary education in Italy at an international school. And I was like, all right, I guess I'll go teach and like travel the world, whatever. And then 2 days later, that big white envelope came. And I was like, oh no, I've been accepted. What do I do? So I said, okay, well, I'm going to go up to New York where I've been a million times, but I maybe I'll go this time and I'll have a sign. And so I took a mock voice lesson with this man named Michael Ricciardoni, and I didn't know anything about him. He just said, come to this building, press 9 on the elevator, and you will see me waiting for you at the end of the hallway. And I said, okay. So the elevator doors open, and there stands this like 6'4", handsome, macho bodybuilder in a tight pink polo. And he's like, hello. And he brings me into this pink office with like a Barbara Streisand clock. And in 10 minutes, he gives me a voice lesson and fixes all of these vocal problems I had had. And I was like, oh my God, you are my sign. I am finally where I'm supposed to be. And so I got to NYU. And then I realized while I was there that they had this dual degree program where I could also study pedagogy. And I was suddenly like, now my life makes sense. I can teach people how to sing, people to do the thing that I love. And so now it's all come very full circle.
That's amazing. I love that story. It's a beautiful journey and path.
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. So you, I mean, we've been in classes together. I've heard you sing so many times, and you are a fierce beltress, and you have impeccable technique, and you are an amazing voice teacher. So how did you end up with a vocal injury?
Yes, I know. It's, you know, there's this stigma that people have where they think, oh, if you have a vocal injury, that means you're a bad singer and you don't know what you're doing. And so I felt so much, I guess, so it goes back to when I was 11 and when they said, you should study singing because you're going to hurt yourself. And I remember that when I was in high school, I never went to the ENT. I never got diagnosed with anything. I don't know why, actually, in retrospect, but I didn't. So I remember going through high school, and every spring we would do the spring musical, and I would always lose my voice by the end of it. And I think, so I had always kind of struggled with stamina and singing, probably like stamina, I think, just doing too much and not knowing when to stop, when to rest, how to properly take care of myself. So when I got to college, it was my sophomore year of college. We did this thing called rehearsal beach week, where we would go with my a cappella group, and we would, for a whole week, we would learn like 4 or 5 songs. We would sing all day. And we were also living in this house with 15 girls. So we were singing all day, singing and speaking and yelling and like having fun all night, not warming up, not taking care of ourselves at all. And by the end of that, I was so vocally fatigued that, again, I lost my voice. And this was really the first time I lost my voice where I was nervous. And so I did go to the ENT. And in college, that year I went to this man in Virginia and he told me that I had pre-nodules. And he was like, unless you make some significant changes in your life, like you're going to have nodes and you're never going to sing again. And I was like, oh my God. Okay, so I did everything he told me. I put my bed on risers. You know, I cut citric food and anything with tomatoes. I started just noticing my vocal usage and what was happening. And so then I did speech therapy, and over the course of a few months, things definitely improved. And then I went about my life and it was fine. And then flash forward to the end of my time at NYU. This is 5 years later. My vocal coach at the time, Frank Shiro, he said, Jenna, your voice just sounds, it just sounds like there's more air escaping than usual. I think you should go get it checked out before you go to do your 3 month summer stock gig. I was like, okay. So I went to the awesome team at NYU, Dr. Amy and Dr. Bransky. And they were like, there's something on your left vocal fold. We're not quite sure what it is, but there's something there. So could have been there for your entire life. We don't really know. But just something to notice and to flag for the future. And I was like, okay. So then I continued on the summer stock journey. I did White Christmas in June and July. I did Cinderella. And then by August, I was rehearsing Rocky Horror by day, where I was playing Columbia, and then singing Cinderella at night, where I was playing Cinderella. And my voice and body were just like, what is happening? And so I was struggling with that because it was a really hard adjustment to transition from that pop rock, like rock grit sound that they wanted into that, you know, legit soprano. So that was the first time I ever took steroids. And I remember I called Dr. Bransky and he was like, listen, this happens. It's fine. You're going to get through it, but you're going to feel like Superman on these drugs. And so don't do anything stupid. Like, don't sing Defying Gravity if you don't have to. And I was like, okay, okay. And even in that moment, I felt a significant amount of shame. And I think I didn't tell anybody, because it was so hard to admit that I wasn't, that something was hard for me, that wasn't hard for other people, you know? And I feel like that's what's so interesting about vocal injuries as a singer, because what other instruments, what other people's bodies are capable of doing, you might not be. And you might be capable of doing things that other people aren't capable of. So it's this interesting, it's one of those moments where you truly understand how individual and how unique every singer is, where you're just like, oh, there's really no rule. There's no one way to do it, because what works for some people isn't going to work for me, and vice versa. So after that summer, I continued on with my life. I didn't have any problems. I was fine. Flash forward, it's like the 5-year curse, you know, like flash forward another 5 years. And last January, I did a 3-month run of the Winter Wonderettes at the Walnut Street Theater in Philly, which is a 2.5-hour musical with 4 women, 4-part harmony the whole time, and you never leave the stage. And we did it without mics. And we were in this dusty black box doing 8 to 9 show weeks. And so after that, I was like, I need to go on vacation. So my husband and I went to visit my cousin who works for NYU Abu Dhabi's campus. So we went to Dubai, Abu Dhabi, and Oman. And as soon as we landed, I got the flu. And I was so sick. I've never been that sick before in my life. And I remember having a 103-degree fever and this ridiculous cough. And I remember in my like fever state, I was crying to my husband, Ben, being like, I'm never gonna sing again. Like, I'm definitely gonna like blow a vocal fold. You know, this is insane. And then 2 months later, I went to the ENT because I was like, something is just not right. It doesn't feel right. And my ENT, Dr. Gwen Corbin, was like, What did you do like a week ago? Did you cough or sneeze or like do something? And I was like, nothing comes to mind where I did anything incorrectly. And she was like, well, you have a hemorrhage. And I was like, what? And I looked at the display over there and I literally went, oh, my baby. And I saw this like yellow vocal fold that had a bleed and it looked so unhappy and so sad. And she was like, you must have done something a week ago because it looks like it's in the process of healing. And I was like, I don't remember doing anything significant last week. And so what ended up happening is Gwen, we waited for the hemorrhage to go away. And this was 3 weeks before I was set to do another show. And I was like, what am I supposed to do? I have to go into rehearsals for this thing at the end of the month. And so she said, you know, we wait for the hemorrhage to heal. Then you have this thing on your left vocal fold. I'm not sure what it is either, but it looks swollen. So we're going to do another round of steroids to see if we can reduce the swelling. And then I think you should go up to see this specialist, Dr. Steven Zeitels in Boston after your show is over and go from there. I was like, okay. So the hemorrhage went away. I went down into rehearsals and I remember feeling that I just felt so scared and I felt such trepidation that other people would know that something was wrong with my voice. I'd worked at this theater before, so I was nervous that they would be like, what's wrong with you? I was scared to push or press or like overdo it and then have the hemorrhage come back. So I was sort of like tiptoeing, but it ended up being fine. The run was fine. Nothing too vocally fatiguing in the show. And I took really good care of myself. And that was the moment where I was like, okay, I know I've like put my bed on risers before, but at this point I'm going to go ham on anything I can that has to do with what I've heard of self-care for singers, you know? So like cut sugar, cut alcohol, cut running. Like, let me just do yoga and Pilates and let me do sleep 8 hours a night. Let me drink that 64 ounces of water every day. Let me warm up. Let me cool down. Let me steam every day. Let me neti pot. Like, let me live this rigorous life like a vocal monk and see if anything changes. And so I did go back to Gwen at the end of this experiment and she did look at my, she did scope me and compare. And she was like, the thing on your left is significantly reduced, but it is still there. So I think you should still go see Zeitels. So I said, okay. So at the time, one of my friends from college a cappella, my like life is so full circle, was Dr. Zeitels' fellow. And so I went up to see Zeitels and Dr. Brandon Jackson Baird, who now works at the University of Chicago. And they were like, yes, you have a polyp on your left side. And the polyp is now causing a polyp on a reactionary polyp on the right side because it continues to hit. And I see this blood vessel, like where you've had this recurring hemorrhage. And like, yes, you got it on tape in March, but I think it's happened to you before. And I was like, you know what? I think you're right. I think that there have been times in my vocal life where I'm like, something is not right. And I never feel like some people feel like a pop or something happen. I've never felt anything happen significantly in the moment, but it's like, a few times in my life, I've had this happen where suddenly my voice just doesn't function as I know that it should. And so I'm like, huh, I feel like this has been a problem for a long time. And I think that this polyp has been there also for a long time. And he was like, I think you're right. I think that it's probably been there since you were a kid or like developed in high school. I was like, okay, well, I know it's there. I've been working with this thing for like, you know, 10 years now. So what do I do? And he was like, well, you have a choice. You can either have surgery and remove it, or you can continue to live life as you know it with this thing, knowing that it will continue to flare up, that it won't ever go away, and that it could eventually decrease your range and increase your anxiety, like whether or not your voice will show up that day. And I was like, my anxiety is so bad. Like, I can't live like this anymore. And he was like, okay, great. So surgery it is. And I was like, great. So I elected to have surgery last June. And he decided to remove polyps from both sides of the vocal folds, as well as laser off any of the potential rupturing blood vessels. And he then gave me a copy of the surgery. It is the coolest thing I've ever watched as a vocal nerd. I'm like, wow. He operated these little alligator claws, and he does it with the tips of his fingers. And he matches his heartbeat to mine so that the body pulses move together. It was truly incredible. And he takes these little alligator things and he folds back the epithelium, which is the mucus covered layer of your vocal fold. And then he goes in and he scoops out this like clear gunk, which is what the polyp is made of. Dr. Paul Kwok at NYU calls it a hemorrhage jelly donut, which is disgusting, but also a beautiful illustration of what exactly it is. So they remove this white goop and then he folds back the layer over top of it, so that you don't have any potential for scar tissue. So they did the surgery. Then he said, you have to do 3 weeks of silence, complete silence, no coughing, no sneezing, no clearing your throat, no speaking, no singing, nothing. I was like, 3 weeks? And then he looked at his calendar and was like, oh, I'm going to be away on vacation when at your 3 week mark. So you get an extra 6 days. And I was like, what? And it was truly actually one of the most beautiful moments of my life. I learned to meditate. I learned to listen. And through it, by the last week, I started to feel nervous about, like, what if I'm like the random case that I go back and I can never speak again? And I was like, actually, I think I could do it. Like, I'd figure it out. I'd still be able to inspire others to like trust themselves. And I don't know, I would figure it out without a voice maybe. Luckily that didn't happen. I went back and he was like, yes, you're good. You're great. You'll be able to sing. And I was like, really? And he was like, yeah, actually stand up and sing me something right now. And I was like, what? And he was like, yeah, right now, stand up. And he's like a little bit intense. So I was like, okay. And I like stood up and sung him something. And I'm actually so glad that he kind of just like forced me into the deep end, because immediately I was like, oh my God, it worked. It worked. I can sing. Like, this is a miracle. And the next day I went to see my voice teacher, Joan Later, and together with her and another one of my colleagues, Ellen Letrick, who is an SLP, we did the proper vocal therapy things and just like learned to sing again. And I was nervous that it would take me months to learn to sing, but I got back into it really quickly. And I noticed after surgery that you have to build your stamina back up, because you are going, it's the same thing. Like, this is why I'm in this like athletic outfit. Like, it's the same thing as your body. You have to keep continually training your muscles or else you'll get weaker. And so it was the same with my voice. Without using it for a month, then I had to, you know, build my strength back up. But after about a month, I felt totally back to normal. And by back to normal, I mean, I felt better than my normal, because now I didn't have anything in my way.
Wow. That's quite the story.
Yeah.
So I have so many questions. The first, I want to backtrack, and you were saying that you felt like something wasn't right. And I'm curious, to you, what was the difference between, you know, just feeling like maybe you oversang one day, or feeling like, oh, like, you know, I could have handled my self-care better, versus like truly feeling like something wasn't right?
So every day I start my day with this check-in, and it's the blowfish check-in. So the blowfish is a semi-occluded vocal tract posture, SOVT, and you puff your cheeks, you make a teeny tiny hole in your lips, and then you let air come through. So I usually will wake up and the first thing I'll do is go into the bathroom and I'll be like, okay, she's good today. Like I can tell from that. That's my baseline. So every day I do that, I can tell versus like depending on the stretch that I feel, the range that I have, the ease of flow, how my voice is going to be that day. Whether that's like a, it feels like a little tired. It feels like my range is smaller. It sounds breathier than usual. There's like a hiccup in the middle of it where the sound stops and I have to wait to come back down for before the sound begins again. Something like that. If one of those things happen, then I say, okay, I should definitely do an extended warm-up today and like see what we're working with. When this happened to me, like my range immediately decreased. I had no top, no high notes. And it felt more laborious. It felt like I had to work harder to be able to produce sounds that were usually really easy for me. And then it also felt like specifically more tense in and around my larynx. So, and I don't know if that's a product of my body trying to help or my anxiety and me being in panic mode. Like I always say when I'm teaching a lesson and someone goes to scary highland, we either collapse like, oh my God, it's too high. Or we push and like double down, like I'm gonna get through it. And I'm like, I don't think either one of those is actually the helpful thing that we could do. So I felt like I was doing more than I normally had to.
I think that's so great and that's such great advice. And it's so important for every singer to have a baseline, I think, and to have some exercise that they can do. I tend to do little squeaky sounds. I like whimper in my high voice, like I just do that. And that will help me tell every day, you know, okay, can I make these sounds easily? Am I tightening up, like you said? Am I not getting quite so high? And then as I warm up during the day, you know, does it get better? Maybe I was just a little tired or, you know, in the next day, is it better? Or if it goes on day after day and it's not working, that I think that's a sign because our voices are very resilient and strong.
Super. And I think you're right. Like sometimes, and I tell people all the time, there are going to be some days where like you didn't sleep, our voices are resilient and they're also very sensitive. So I always ask people, and I go through this myself too. I'm like, my voice feels like meh today. What is that? And I'm like, I didn't really sleep very well last night. Or you know what? I was on the phone till like midnight talking to people. Or I drank yesterday. Like I had 3 or 4 glasses of wine and I shouldn't have done that. Or like I didn't drink any water while I was out. You know, so I can kind of go back through the Rolodex of like, what did I do yesterday? And like, how is that impacting me today? And then sometimes it's like, it's just better to take a day off and it's better to let your voice rest. And then other times it's like, well, my voice actually doesn't feel that bad. Like, I think I can warm up and work through it and it will, I can navigate it back to its normal point.
Yes. I tell my students that all the time. Like if it's just not working on that day,
just let it stop. Go.
Yeah. I think we often feel that, I don't know, this pressure of like, we got to get it right. We got to do it. And if it's just a normal practice session, I mean, I always think just rest, sing on a good day. So you're getting those good reps in and yes, we want to work through it, but
yeah. And Gina, as you know, like there's so many other things that we can do on these days when we wake up and are like, this doesn't feel that great. So like, what can I do instead? Can I work on phonemes? Can I get cleaner and crisper with my consonants? Can I think about my lyrics and like personalize my text? You know, can I research this composer and like understand their musical styling better? There's 100 other things we can do as singers. Can I just do yoga? Like, what if it's my body that day that's actually in my way? Because, you know, I actually think about this a lot, like at the beginning of the pandemic and when Donald Trump became president, were two moments where I was like, my voice feels terrible. Something is not right. And I remember I saw Joan maybe 3 or 4 days after the 2016 election. And she was like, every singer that's come into my studio has said the same thing. They're like, I can't sing. And it's because all of these muscles in and around our neck and body are just stressed and carrying that tension. So the same thing happened at the beginning of this pandemic in March. I saw Christine Schneider and was like, Christine, I need a self-care session, a virtual one, because I feel like I don't know what's happening. And she was like, it's your body. Your body's just responding to the world and you're carrying that in your physicality. So in these days when our voice isn't responding, you can go back through the Rolodex of what did I do yesterday? And perhaps it's not even a moment to accuse yourself or blame yourself for overdoing it. It might be a moment of like, oh, I actually, like, my mental state is impacting where I am today. So perhaps I could do something like breath work oriented instead.
Yes, I love that. So going back, you know, we're talking about destigmatizing vocal injury. And I guess I'm wondering, what do you wish people knew about vocal injury, or what do you wish you knew?
Well, you know, it's funny, like when I went up to see doctors, when the hemorrhage happened, when I went to see Dr. Gwen and she told me I had hemorrhage, I immediately went into the shame spiral of like, people pay me to teach them to sing. I can't even sing, apparently. You know, I'm a terrible singer. I have no technique. This is all my fault. What have I done? Da, 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 da. And do I tell anyone? I don't know. And eventually people started, it was almost like a 1920s speakeasy where people would be like, hey, that happened to my friend. Don't tell them I sent you, but like, you should reach out to so-and-so and like talk to them about their vocal surgery or like what happened to them. I'm like, what? Oh, so then I went on this search and I found all these people that I love, respect, and admire, and like have incredible long careers. And I'm like, wait a minute, this is way more prevalent than we think. And this is like, all of a sudden I made this connection. My husband's into sports. And I was like, wait, singers are athletes. Athletes get injured. Athletes get injured all the time on playing fields. And the way that they report it is it's very dry and it's very matter of fact. So they're like, Derek Jeter broke his elbow, out for 6 months, period. Kobe Bryant tore his Achilles, out for the year, whatever it is. So, but then when you research singer injuries, you see all these headlines that are like, so-and-so devastated over the loss of her voice. Like, this guy lost his voice. Bad singing technique. It's like accusatory on the singer instead of just stating the facts. And so I suppose what I wish that people knew is I wish that they knew how prevalent this was. And I wish that they knew that it could just be as simple as stating the facts and removing all of the emotional attachment and or accusation and blaming that happens.
Oof.
And I also, one more thing, is I wish that people knew that going to the doctor, going to the ENT to get scoped isn't a death sentence. So many times when I recommend to one of my singers, like, hey, you consider yourself a professional. This is your livelihood. This is your moneymaker, your gift. Have you ever gone to the doctor to see it on camera? And they're like, no, why should I? What's wrong? What do you think? And I'm like, nothing is even wrong. I'm just curious. These things make you money. Like, this is the thing that makes you unique and special and like talented. Why wouldn't you want to get to know it?
Yes. I love that you said that. And I feel so grateful personally that, similar to you, when I started singing, it was high school, I had some issues that made me go to the ENT. I actually woke up with a cyst on my thyroid one morning. It was just totally out of the blue.
It just came, wow.
Yeah, it was very bizarre. And then I was a cheerleader in high school. So we were monitoring the cyst and I started to get hoarse, and thankfully my teacher was a vocal health nut, and he said, you need to go get scoped. and I had pre-nodules. And so my vocal health journey started very, very early. And that made me comfortable, I think, getting scoped. So, I mean, to me, I need to get scoped pretty regularly just for my own peace of mind. But yeah, it shocks me that people have never been scoped. And it can be scary. You know, you think of this thing going either down your mouth or up your nose. And but I actually find it very comforting to know what my cords are supposed to look like, know that everything's good.
I totally agree. And I'm also like, oh, look, they're my vocal babies right there. I love them. So I love going to the doctor. I love getting scoped. I love getting help. I think knowledge is power. And, you know, I also think about what Dr. Zeitels told me when I finally could speak again. And he said, because I said, this has been a wild experience. And he said, it's not necessarily a technique problem. It's an enthusiasm problem. Like singers and performers, we're enthusiastic people. And we tend to dive into things. We are all in. And I think about shows, right? And when you have to miss a show, it's such a difficult decision because you're like, oh, but that's my family. You know, they're relying on me. I want to be there. I want to be part of the group. I want to be part of this collaborative artistic experience. I don't want to let anybody down. Even though we should also be able to take care of ourselves and, you know, call out when we need to. That's why we have swings. That's why we have understudies. The show must go on, but should you, you know, is the question that I talk about.
Oh, I love that reframe. I'm going to start using that. The show must go on, but should you? That's great. So you mentioned some of the lessons that you learned during that silent period. And I'd love for you to elaborate more on that. On your recovery journey and just what you still take with you that you learned?
Well, I was just having this conversation with someone yesterday who she wants to start a blog. And she said, you know, I'm scared about starting a blog and making it like a dear diary kind of situation. And I said, actually, what I've noticed is that the more vulnerable and the more personal I get on my blog or in my lessons or whatever I'm doing in my life, the more people respond, the more people feel seen themselves, the more people feel heard, and the more supported they feel knowing that somebody else is sharing their experience. So I used to think, one of the lessons that I learned is that I used to think strength was this, you know, I'm Ukrainian. So we have this mentality of like, we're strong people, we'll get through it. But I'm like, yes, we can be strong people and also be vulnerable and be human at the same time. So strength doesn't have to be this wall. Strength can be sharing and being open about needing help or asking for what you need. You know, when I was silent, I had a note on my phone and I would hold it up to people like, and it would say, hi, my name is Jenna and I just had vocal surgery and can't speak. Can I please have a tall coffee? Thank you so much for all of your help today. And I'd hold it up to the barista and I'd watch them be like, oh, oh my, yes. Like yes, of course. And everyone was so nice. And I was like, it gave me this newfound appreciation for humanity. I was like, people are inherently helpful. They want to be able to help. We are all just scared of each other or something. And so we hide and we make it difficult for people to help us because we think being helped is weakness. When actually being helped helps them as well. Because now, like, think about that person who helped me today because I couldn't speak. And now they can walk away feeling like they did someone a favor. And that's a great feeling. Why are we robbing each other of that feeling and of being able to help?
Oh, I love that. That's beautiful. That reminds me when I was in high school and going through the vocal issues, my mom made me a little sign. It was a necklace that went around my neck and it said, I'm on vocal rest.
So cute.
Yeah. And it's true. I think that when we ask for what we need, it's not an imposition on other people. Other people want to know what you need and how they can support and how they can help. And it gives them room to be encouraging as well. versus, you know, creating that divide of like, I don't want to offend. I don't want to, maybe I should speak, even though I really need to be silent. I was struck by something that you said. You were talking about being vulnerable and being open and finding strength in that. And it dawned on me that there's a parallel to belting.
Say more.
So, you know, there's all sorts of singers and voice teachers in this group. And some come from the classical tradition, some come from musical theater tradition and other styles as well. And likewise, when I was young, my belt was a scream. And to be frank, sometimes it still is. That is my thing that I keep working on all the time. And what I've come to learn was that belting is not a scream. There actually is quite a bit of head resonance in that belt. It actually is much lighter than I thought that it was. It requires being physically very expansive and open. And yet the sound is so strong that comes out. Mm-hmm. And so I would just love to hear you talk about belting in a healthy way, because there's so many misconceptions about that. And I think there's like an old school misconception that that belting can lead to injury.
I know. Actually, while you were saying that, I was thinking, I wonder if there are some voice teachers sitting in here who are like, see, she's a belter. That's why she got a hemorrhage. And I'm like, what? No, I'm a singer. I've been classically trained. Like, I went to Steinhardt. That's a classical program. So I think that, again, there's this idea that we blame a thing like, oh, well, it's belting. That's what did it. No, it's probably an enthusiasm thing where I was singing, I was teaching for 6 hours, and then I'd go right to a singing class without having warmed up myself, or like, I'm just overexerting myself. That's why I got injured, you know? Belting, I always say the best sopranos make the best belters. So it is very important for you to spend time working on your head voice. I'm so grateful. My voice teacher at NYU, Rosa Vento, she put me on the head voice diet when I first got to Steinhardt. And she was like, you're going to spend the entire semester singing in head voice, no belting, just like consider it a challenge and like do with it what you will. And I was like, okay. And I think, again, it goes back to that strength thing, whereas women in 2020 were like, well, I want to be taken seriously in this male-dominated culture, so I'm going to speak in a lower register, and I'm going to try to put more power in my voice. And like floating doesn't really live in my normal speaking range because I'm afraid that it makes me feel like dainty and weak. But when we spend time in that range, as belters, we actually increase our belting range because we now have more accessibility across the board. And so, I mean, it's fun to talk about belting with Joan because often we're like, what is belting? Like, belting to me might be different than it is to you. We're always all arguing over like, is that a belt or is that a mix or like, what is that? And it's like, I don't know. I mean, belting is a certain sound. It's glorified yelling on pitch. It is kind of yelling, you know? I mean, it is the same thing. And so I think it is a mix. You know, I'll give you my Oreo cookie analogy, right? So you always have two cookies on your Oreo. You have head voice over here and chest voice over here. It's the same with singing. In the middle, you have all of these different options of Oreos these days. You have double stuff, thin, you have mint, you have the orange ones at Halloween, you have birthday cake, whatever. It's the same with singing. When people are like, can you belt that? You're like, yes. What kind of belt would you like? Would you like Ethel Merman? Would you like Laura Osnes? Would you like Patti LuPone 1976 Evita? Or would you like Cynthia Erivo? Like who do you want? Because all of those are different styles of singing. So if you know that head and chest voice always exist, what we're doing is playing with the middle. And so then that's just a ratio of head and chest voice. So is it a 50-50? Is it 80-20? You know, what is it?
I love that. I always use the analogy of the salt and pepper shakers.
Yeah. So,
yeah, it's like, you know, how much salt and how much pepper? It's probably not going to be 50-50, but, you know,
Well, and is this an anecdote? No, it's like a story. But, you know, Cynthia Erivo takes lessons with Joan as well. And when she was doing Color Purple, she was working on Italian arias all the time. You can look at her Instagram where she was posting what she was working on. And so when you're belting, when your livelihood is belting, and say you're playing Elsa in Frozen and you know you're going to sing Let It Go every night, you don't necessarily need to work on that all the time in your home practice. What you can be doing instead is those Italian arias, that head voice stuff, because once again, like, it's just going to infuse and help to strengthen both sides of both the salt and the pepper. I love it.
So you mentioned working out and, you know, you're in your tank top. And I'm wondering what other practices you have in your life that other people can employ to take care of their vocal health.
Mm. Well, singers are athletes. Athletes get injured. So there's your little tagline. My dad is a personal trainer. And so I grew up with an emphasis on fitness. I played soccer. I was a swimmer, lacrosse, field hockey, like all of the things. And so I've always had a strong physical practice. And then when I started working with Joan, we'd had a lot of conversations about, you know, your hips might be tight, or you need to like strengthen your transverse abdominis. And I suddenly started to realize, wow, there is so much. We always talk about like your body is your instrument. And then like they leave it at that. And you're like, well, what am I supposed to do with that information as a singer? Like, yes, I get it. I'm accepting that. And now what? So Tim and I are actually starting this brand new workshop next week called Let's Get Physical, where we are literally combining forces with physical experts who are also singers. So we have a personal trainer, a Pilates instructor, gyrotonic, yoga, and meditation. And they're all going to come in and talk about the benefits of these schools of physical movement on the singer and what the singer should know when and if they are looking to employ some of these techniques in their practice. And I'm geeking out about it because I'm like, finally, I'm doing the full circle thing again. I'm combining my love of fitness with my love of singing. And now I'm going to know where that crossover is. I look at people like Cynthia and like Sutton, who, when I watch them sing, like you said, belting is this full body experience. I always say belting comes from the back. So we use our larger muscle groups to help our two tiny flaps of skin that are the length of the end of our pinky finger to do all that heavy lifting. If we think we can belt from a relaxed physical position, and by relaxed, I truly mean like disengaged, we're going to do ourselves a disservice because we're going to have too much pressure at the level of the vocal folds, which will cause the fatigue or the injury. So to avoid that, we can use the little box, our head, and our big box, the shoulders to our hips, to support our vocal box in sound production. And so I'm excited about this workshop, and I'm excited. I always get up every morning and you ask me to think about like, what's a day in the life like? Well, I told you I wake up, I immediately do some blowfishes to decide where my voice is. And then from there, I always work out because I know for me, a morning workout will ensure that like my body's warmed up. I'm in my body that day. I can assess where I feel tension, tightness, soreness. And then from there, I can move into whatever vocal demands I have, knowing that my physical instrument is already warmed up.
Oh, that's great. So you got me thinking about how oftentimes as singers, we're often told what not to do. We're often told, don't tense, don't scream.
Right, right, right.
And for me, when you said relaxing is disengaging, I thought back to many, many years of voice training in which I was not supporting at all because I knew that I was being tense and I was being told, relax, relax. But I didn't know what that meant. So what to do? And I love what you're talking about because you're giving us so many tools of what we actively can do for self-care rather than, you know, don't.
Ooh, yes. Yes, on my resume, I say proud practicer, proud practitioner of yes and. Because I think it's like, yes, the idea of relaxation is great. And we have to consider that our body operates in oppositional forces. So areas of tension and areas of release. So if we're feeling tense here, perhaps it's because we're feeling release here. What if we switch it? What if we feel release here and then tension otherwhere, aka support, right? But yeah, you're totally right. Singing, I think it's such an old, it's an old world, right? Where we've been working on singing technique since the Italians began singing, you know, operas back in the 15th, 16th, 17th century. So I think that there is an old school way of thinking about things and saying, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. And I think instead in our modern day, what you and I are working toward is encouraging. What if we look at it in a different way where it's not a negative berating moment and instead it's a freedom moment of like, this might not be working, so I could consider doing this instead.
And this also made me think about, you're talking about bringing in all of those movement modalities and workout modalities. And then earlier you're talking about, singing a classical song to help with your belts. And also you were saying about, well, maybe today I won't run, I'll do yoga. And I think that all ties together as well. It's like, what do we need at this moment on this day based on where we're at? And in terms of staying healthy and being physical and working out, like that is so important, but specifically what we're doing, what kind of repertoire we're singing, what kind of workout we're doing.
Yeah.
That can be very flexible.
Well, and Gina, you know, going back to, again, what you asked me about, what did I learn in that period of silence? And I said, I learned to listen, and that means to others, but also to myself. And so I think that that's a great thing for singers to remember is it's noisy out there. Like the minute you leave your apartment in New York City, it costs you $60. And it's also, you're just like getting bombarded by people and things and all of this. So in those moments of noise, we have to figure out how to go internal so that we can hear what our body needs, what we need. And I think it's hard when there are pressures of, I think of Broadway productions where there's a lot of pressure because it's a lot of money on the line. And so there is this tendency to want to push and to want to show up for the demands. And there are a lot of demands and they do ask a lot of performers. And so how can we balance the necessities of our job, or how can we balance the job requirements with also the self-care and awareness of sticking up for ourselves and what we need and still contributing in service of the show or of the project that we're doing? That's kind of a question that I think we can all continue to ask ourselves. And but I think that it's important for singers to remember to make room or to take a moment and just do a body scan, just check in.
That's so important. That's great. So I have two final questions that I ask all guests, and they're based on Victorian parlor games, but not really. I changed them up. So the first one is called Lighting the Candle, and it used to be a silly game where two people would kneel down and try to light each other's actual candles, and then they would fall over, and it'd be really funny. But the idea of lighting the candle, I think, is beautiful. So I am wondering whose work would you like to illuminate? It can be a person, an organization, a resource.
I would like to light the candle of Ellen Letrick and the Fund for College Auditions. It is a New York City-based nonprofit that offers financial support and college guidance to acting and musical theater students with limited resources who want to audition for post-high school training programs. So it's a wonderful organization that is working to truly eliminate the gap that we see in being able to afford a musical theater college program and college experience. Because if you think about all of the costs that happen before you even get to college, the training costs, the application costs, the pre-screen costs, the auditions, flying to the auditions themselves, the cost of all of that, that really reduces the amount of students that are able to afford to even participate in the competition to get into these programs. And so TFCA is working toward reducing that, and they work with scholars for, you know, you, I think you apply for the program and then all of your fees are waived. So the Fund for College Auditions will pay for the training, will pay for the applications, will pay for any and all costs so that these students are getting a fair shake at competing to get into these programs. So I'm very passionate about education, and I'm very passionate about equity and diversity, and making our theatrical community more reflective of the world that we see and the world that we want to see in the future.
Snaps to that.
Yeah.
That's great. If you want to send me the link, I can post it for people.
I will.
And then the other question is based on a game called The Parrot. And people would go around a circle and repeat a word or a phrase. So if we were all your parrots, what would you teach us to say?
The thing that's been sticking in my head most often over the past 2 months is Brené Brown saying, I'm here to get it right, not be right. I'm here to get it right, not be right. And I really love that idea of, you know, at IVS, we value growth, belonging, and teamwork. And in particular, with the idea of a growth mindset, we are never going to be seniors in our education. We are always going to be learning. And so if we can forgive ourselves for our knowledge gaps or for, you know, the missteps that we may make or the things that we say that aren't quite as clear as we wanted them to be, we can remember, I am here to get it right, not be right. And that will give us that freedom to express ourselves and to try and to fall and to fail and then try again.
I'm here to get it right, not be right.
Yes.
That's awesome. Jenna Pastuszek, thank you so much for being a guest on the Practice Parlour today.
Thanks, Tina.
Welcome. So grateful to you and for everybody who watched either live, or I'm sure many more will be watching the replay. So thank you. Thank you for sharing your experience, your vulnerability, and your wisdom with us.
Yay! Happy singing!